back to another episode of the Black Excellence series. If you have not yet subscribed to my channel, what are you waiting for? As always, don't be a bystander, be a part of the revolution. Press the subscribe button and get anyone else you know to click subscribe and join the revolution. So let's get straight into it. Hi sir, how are you doing?
Good, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us. So, can you tell us a bit about yourself? Who are you? Where do you come from? What do you do?
All right. My name is Dumi Sole. Mm-hmm. I think people see me as this popular guy on Twitter.
Right.
But I'm literally a guy from Dobsonville, Soweto. I was raised by a single mom. I lost my dad when I was 15. And literally from an informal settlement.
So, can you tell us exactly what do you do?
All right. I don't know, professionally or Twitter?
Professionally first, and then we'll go on to Twitter.
Okay, cool. So I'm an admitted attorney of the High Court of South Africa. I have over 7 or 8 years of post-practice experience. So I'm a litigator, I'm an employment attorney, and I'm now into strategy and government relations. And I work for a mining house and one of the top listed companies in the New York Stock Exchange, London, and South Africa. So that's what I do ordinarily.
So now moving on to your persona on Twitter, we're going to talk about Country Duty.
Sure.
When people think about Country Duty, they think you. But you mentioned before that you are not Country Duty. It's more than just you. So can you tell us what exactly is Country Duty and who is involved in it?
Okay. So Country Duty is a social movement. It's a hashtag. And it really has gained popularity. I think it's one of the biggest, in my view, trending hashtags that Twitter has ever seen. In my view, I see it as a South African hashtag. It brings South Africans together to deal with issues from politics, socio-economic issues, injustices, but more importantly, how we can, particularly as Black people, provide solutions to the country right. in a way that is not political or politically affiliated. Mm. So that's in essence what hashtag Country Duty is and what it aspires to do.
So you mentioned the part of being politically affiliated. Now you're very vocal about what your political standing is. And has that actually affected Country Duty work, or has that led to people actually crediting Country Duty's work to a particular party?
All right, and also that's an excellent question. And I think it's very important because, so Dumi is Dumi, right? And
right.
Dumi is an individual, as I said, and has his own life. The hashtag, I said it belongs to South African. I curated, I coordinated, I get people together. So, but I just want to emphasize that aspect relating to Country Duty and Dumi as an individual. Me working corporate SA, supporting or being aligned politically to the EFF, for example, and then projecting from a Country Duty perspective, it just confuses people. And people actually don't understand that all these things can coexist. I just want to draw two, if not three, examples. On a Country Duty perspective and on an EFF or Dumi perspective or personal perspective, if the allegations or the view is this is politically aligned, I say that's incorrect for various reasons. One of them being in Alex, where there was a fire and one said on hashtag Country Duty and us South Africans to come together, contribute, be it food, clothing and stuff, people did that.
Right.
And Alex, as you know, it is currently being ran by the DA, and it's in Gauteng, and it's not another indication that this is linked to the DA or support of the DA.
Right.
And if you look at where Gauteng is, where the ANC is currently running, it's an ANC province. They have the majority, you know, especially coming after the elections, and an influence to a certain extent.
Mm.
So it just points out that if this was an EFF project, I could have held back, you know, and said, but listen, let the DA or all these other people solve this particular problem. The last example that I want to demonstrate to show that it's not politically aligned or affiliated was there was a medical student final year who didn't have 68,000 rand to graduate, and this is a vet student. You know, that post was on Facebook, but one of the doctors that follow me and a friend of mine came in and said, I don't know what to do. I probably have 500 rands, but it's not enough.
Mm.
In 4 days, she has to graduate so that she can change lives as you would normally do. But the system, it's such that it won't make it permissible. What then we do? Like always, hashtag Country Duty, Hashtag Dr. Z will graduate, because the name was Zandile. And then we set out to start contributing. I put my 100 rand and I said, through a post, come together. This is my first contribution. How do you want to then do it? You know, day one, we were sitting at 20,000 rand with South Africans coming in and saying, listen, let's make a change.
Wow.
Day two, we were almost at 40 and 48. The third day, we were sitting at, I think, closer to 50 or 55.
Mm.
And there was a 10 or 15,000 that was short. And you know, we kept on updating South Africans. And South Africans of all political affiliations and stuff contributed and made sure that Dr. Z graduates, right? And one of the international followers who had money said, listen, what's the balance? Did an EFT. And the long and short of it is, we found Dr. Z and we made sure that she graduates and she's able to help. Tantra Duty is a social movement, it's for South Africans, and it really gets things done.
You guys challenge many government institutions, many systems. That has to come with a level of unsafety on your part.
Yeah.
Now, how do you deal with matters of safety to make sure that you and your family are safe ultimately, because you're challenging the whole country ultimately?
100%. So safety is very important, and we need to make sure that we tread carefully, right? So there have been instances where we've been threatened, you know, because of us either discussing or exposing corruption and stuff. But the way the hashtag has grown and the people that we've aligned with, you are able to refer a threat to someone and the law enforcement is able to attend to it and deal with that particular threat. I want to send a shout out to, you know, law enforcement, where if there's an issue, they're able to come immediately and say, listen, this is the issue, this is how we can assist or report it to us and stuff. So that's what happens.
Mm. So you guys rely a lot on public information. So people come to you and let you know, okay, this is going on, we need help with this. How do you manage people coming with false stories or, for instance, trying to scam you by saying, oh, I need money to graduate and whatever? How do you manage that to ensure that the information that you receive is accurate and that you, as a result, act properly?
100%. You know, with such a huge hashtag and such a huge responsibility, South Africans, they're bound to be mistakes, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've had instances where someone has come out, especially on racism and very toxic issues.
Mm-hmm.
Someone, there was a lady allegedly working for Bank X, and someone took a post on Facebook and said, this lady works at Bank X, and look at what this person has said. This is the apartheid flag, the pledging allegiance, and they're calling us the K word and everything else. Obviously, that's very insulting and that's
right.
Very worrying. But as you learn and try and gain trust and ensure that there's accountability from a South African perspective, you then make mistakes, but you own up.
Mm-hmm.
So what then happened is I got this information, I spoke to my team, and you know, it was one of those, listen, we need to call this, we need to deal with Bank X, not deal with it, but rather ask it to do what's best. Now, unbeknown, tweet goes out, starts trending, 1,500. Tweets and more.
Mm.
And now the pressure comes in, because at the time we attacked that Bank X and we said, what are you doing with it?
Right.
Now Bank X was obligated to answer and said, listen, we are investigating, we'll get back to you. Now people then reach out to DMs and say, just give us the name, we will try and find out internally, because now we know what you're doing and why it's important and stuff. Send out the details, they looked at the system, they said, listen, buddy, this is a false alarm and this is not it. And remember, at the time, that thing is gaining traction, it's
right,
trending.
Right.
You have journalists already running a story to say Bank X is involved in a racism scandal and whatnot.
Mm.
And at the time, sadly, no one even came to us to say, can we take this story for us to proceed on leads and verify this? Are you sure?
Right.
And none of that happened, right? And before you know it, 5 p.m., Bank X says, listen, we've done with our investigation. Person no longer doesn't work here, never worked here. We don't know and what it means.
Mm.
Now, that's very embarrassing, firstly.
Right.
And may well have caused reputational harm to this particular bank and could have been sued, right?
Yeah.
But because I think Bank X, realizing the value of the hashtag, realizing what we wanted to do, They then said this matter, they consider it closed. But as I was, and I took full responsibility, I was able then to put up a tweet that deleted the initial one, but it had gone viral in any event. And I apologized, I took accountability, and I said, this is one mistake that we've done, and it really didn't go through our control measures, and I apologize for that.
Right.
But what that apology meant is now, you know, being in a situation where people can acknowledge when they're wrong, they can trust that I'm not going to say that's okay and move on, whereas that may have had severe consequences. But it really got us to a situation where we are able to interact, own up on our mistakes and stuff. So to answer your question, we now have a system. When we get information, we verify it.
Right.
So we try and instill control measures in such a way that we avoid being scammed or scamming South Africans.
You know, when you go on Twitter, you see people who are saying hashtag country duty, I'm ready for duty, what do you need me to do? How do you deal with people who are potentially too harsh in trying to help? So for instance, if there's a reported issue and now instead of people doing maybe as you guys recommended, they instead want to go beat people, they want to, you know, how do you manage that?
Yeah, it's a crazy thing, and it's a risk, right, that we've also identified. We tread carefully because we understand that, you know, most of the issues, especially racially related incidents, are very toxic and are very triggering. If you look at what happened to SA2 in Cape Town recently, 2 days ago,
right,
and you'd have seen through hashtag country duty, and you know, I started hashtag justice for SA2, it opened up a very interesting conversation. And people now, most and some, we need to go there, you know, these cops and stuff. But because of the responsibility and what we've been trusted to do, we then, you know, tweet positive messages. Violence is not the answer, it can never be.
Right.
Because if lawlessness was, then we all cease to exist. So there comes an element of responsibility. So we encourage people not to be violent, not to take haste decisions. If you are a foot soldier for country duty, there are certain elements and requirements that we expect from you. One of those is being an example and being an ambassador for country duty. Doesn't relate to you treating racist stuff, violent, and encouraging all of that.
So, you know, a lot of people have this thing of, I really want to help people, I really want to do something, but they don't know where to start. What made you think Twitter, country duty, this is how I'm going to help?
100%. Twitter is the biggest, in my view, platform to ever hit the global space of technology. I mean, Facebook is huge because it connects friends and stuff, but I don't think it is, in my view, because I know Twitter, right? And I've seen how impactful it is. It's instant. You know, journalists, newsrooms are now becoming redundant because everyone is a journalist now. When something breaks, the first thing you do, you go into your account, you tweet it. And then depending on who picks it up, if you put it on country duty or you tag me, and at the time I'm not busy or someone else sees it, retweets it, that thing blows up. People wanting to help, they may well do so and become patrons of country duty. They can own up their stories and be able to tell that. So it's really you doing what you think is best for the country and equivocating it on Twitter. And Twitter is such a powerful platform.
So our final question for this interview is, according to you, what is Black excellence?
Thank you for that question. I think Black excellence is a real thing, right? It's a real thing because I would like to think, amongst other things, I represent that to a certain extent. I'm a professional, I've immense responsibilities, be it at work or in society. It's not funded through corrupt activities or otherwise. Black excellence is professionals out there doing their part to uplift their fellow counterparts, be it white or otherwise, right? But making a change. Our unsung heroes that are not on Twitter, but when you sit and say, listen, I need 100 rands or so to at least help, they sit there and say, listen, I actually have 10,000 rand. Use it. Don't even tag me, you know. This is the least that I can do. So that's Black excellence. And really the stereotype that Black excellence is corrupt or otherwise is actually untrue. We work so hard. There are people who are doing so much that we don't even know of them. There are very innovative people out there, and those are real people who are real and living the Black Excellence mantra. And they work amongst us. And I think what you are doing with these interviews, you are elevating those people. And I think it's time that we tell our stories in such a way that we understand it, and in such a way that our people can then also say, I don't even have to be in corporate SA. If I'm able to change or employ one or two people and do so without depending on government or, you know, breaching the laws of the country, that is Black Excellence. We are not trust fund babies where everything is set up. We are literally in an unequal society, and we are playing catch up. And we are doing so well that we are becoming a threat. And it's okay to become a threat as long as you disrupt and disrupt positively. That's what we need to do. And for me, that's a definition of Black Excellence.
Something I like doing with all my interviews at the end of them is I have here a bowl of tongue twisters, right? And so you get to pick one tongue twister. You have 30 seconds to pick one and read it out as fast as you can.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to get the timer. Okay, and 3, 2, 1, go. A stick.
Peter Piper picked a pen of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers Peter Piper picked.
One more time? Quicker.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers Peter picked. Oh no, I missed Peter Piper.
Okay, we have one more. You have 12 more seconds.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers Peter Piper picked. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers Peter Piper picked.
Wow, that's Black Excellence. In time, up to now, I still can't say it. I get up to Pete. Yeah, that's
right. Hi, my name is Tumi Sole. You are now watching Black Excellence series brought to you by Benita Daniels. And I am the founder of hashtag Country Duty, one of South Africa's biggest hashtags. Follow at Country Duty ZA and celebrate Black Excellence.
Thank you. So guys, that's it for today. I hope you liked this video. Don't forget to comment, like, share, and do you know? Subscribe.
Subscribe, yes. You need to sort me out on my YouTube channel.